So once again, good morning to all lovely doctors, and yeah, once again, welcome to Hall Kenmin. Welcome to AIOC 2021. So starting with our next session, I would like to invite our chairperson, Dr. Rajiv Chaudhary. I request chairperson to please go ahead with the speakers. Thank you so much.
Good morning, all. All the speaker and the probable audience. This is it. Program on tackling subluxated cataract and intraocular lens, and it is purely a video-based program. We have the eminent faculty with us. Dr. Mahipal Sajjav, Chairman of the Center for Sight and our President during this helm of the COVID. He will be going to speak in role of hooks and ring. Then Dr. Harbans Lal, Director of Delhi Eye Center, he will be going, speaking on the IOL repositioning. And yesterday he was elected as our Vice President. Congratulations to him. Dr. Ashok Shroff, Director of Shroff Eye Hospital, Navsari. He will be speaking on IOL exchange. Dr. Rajesh Joshi, Professor GMC, Nagpur. Senior Professor, he will be elaborating on the surgical pulse to deal with the subluxated cataract. And Dr. Vijay Kumar Nishlani, Director, SV Eye Care and LASIK Center. And currently, he is the Chairman, Scientific Committee, MPSOS. He will be going to speak on scleral fixated and glued IOLs. And at last, myself, Dr. Rajiv Chaudhary, going to speak on retrofixation of iris cloth. So, we just start, and initially first is the doctor. I invite Dr. Rajesh Joshi to speak on surgical pulse to deal with the subluxated cataract. Rajesh.
Yeah. Thank you, sir, for this opportunity. I will be talking on surgical pulse to deal with subluxated cataract. Nothing to disclose. Now, before we go on to the surgical pulse, let us see what are the indications for surgical procedure. Subluxated cataractous lens, gross amount of refractive error due to subluxation, impending subluxation of the lens due to large zoomer distance wherein lens is going to fall into the vitreous cavity or coming into the anterior chamber, lens-induced glaucoma, lens in the anterior chamber. Now, there are various fixation devices which are available, and you have to choose them judiciously depending upon the clock hours of the subluxation. If you have less than 4 hours subluxation, then you can fix the bag with the help of capsular tension ring or with the help of capsular tension segments. If you have subluxation between 4 to 9 o'clock hours, modified capsular tension ring, that is Sioux's ring, or a combination of capsular tension ring and segment. Now, pearl number one is the incision. How to place our incision, that is very important for the perfect outcome of the procedure. It should be away from the zonal dehiscenced area, both the incision, that is side port, and the main incision. Staining with trifam blue helps in the identification of the age of the entry capsule while placing the capsular tension ring, but put the small amount of dye into the entry chamber, because what happens if you put too much amount of dye into the entry chamber, that can go into the vitreous cavity and stain the vitreous. Pearl number two is plug the area with high molecular weight viscoelastic. If you have subluxation here, you should plug the area with high molecular weight viscoelastic, because if you don't plug it, that can cause the vitreous loss from that area. Pearl number three is CCC. It is mandatory for the placement of endocapsular ring. Creation of entry capsular flap with the help of 26 gauge bent needle is important, because if you pinch the capsule, it can further compromise the zonules. And rotating the flap with the help of capsular axis forcep or with the help of 26 gauge needle with whatever you are comfortable with, make it slightly eccentric, because once you pull the bag with the help of capsular tension ring or with the help of capsular hook, the capsular axis should come into the center part of the pupil. It is mandatory for the placement of endocapsular ring. Now, how to identify the zoonotic weakness, usually seen while performing the capsulorhexis. You can see the folds on the anterior chamber, anterior capsule. There will be difficulty in pulling the capsule. Movement of the lens is also seen. And you can see the extravasation of the dye from the zoonotes. The nucleus will be difficult to rotate while performing the chopping of the nucleus. Hydro procedure, hydro dissection should be gentle. Don't use too much of fluid for hydro dissection, and you should avoid the rotation of the nucleus. You can see the extravasation of the dye from the zoonotic area. Now the timing of placement of endocapsular ring is debatable. You can place it after the CCC, that is before management of the nucleus, or after the nucleus and corticle removal. These are the various types and sizes of back fixation devices. First is a traditional capsular tension ring. Second is a modified, you can see a small eyelet here, and the capsular tension segment. Most commonly used size is between 11 to 13 millimeter, because most of the patients, they are having axial length between 23 to 28 millimeter. And if you have a large bag, you can use larger size of the endocapsular ring. Now, placement of endocapsular ring before the nucleus management. Once you have rhexis, the advantage of this act makes the surgery safe, because you know that your bag is well supported by endocapsular ring. Ring provides equatorial support to the back. It prevents zoonotic stress on the zoonotes. But the disadvantage of placing the endocapsular ring before the nucleus management is that it makes the cortical aspiration difficult. And insertion of the endocapsular ring makes the zoonotic weak. So don't delay too much for the placement of endocapsular ring. That is the dictum. Now, how do we place the endocapsular ring? Once you have aspirated the loose cortex, either with the help of the FICO probe or with the help of bimanual irrigation aspiration patch, place the viscoelastic so that there is a space between the intercapsular ring and the nucleus. And place, you can either place it single-handedly or with the help of two hands. Once you have the ring in the bag, the trailing eyelet should be hooked with the help of the dialer, and the second dialer, which is instilled through the main incision, places the ring into the bag. This is another way to implant the endocapsular ring. Once you have endocapsular ring in the zoonotic dehiscence stage, you can see the zoonotic dehiscence here, and placing the endocapsular ring. But at the same time, by pushing the dialer through the main incision, I am supporting the shaft of the endocapsular ring and at the same time placing the ring into the bag, so that prevents the zoonotic stress. It can be placed after the nucleus removal also. You can see zoonotic dehiscence here near the incision site, and this part of the capsulorhexis has straightened up. So while placing the endocapsular ring, place the ring in such a way that it negotiates the dehiscence area first, and then the rest of the ring can be dialed into the bag as I have just described. Now, nucleus management, you can do whatever way you are performing your nucleus management, but I prefer to go with the chop technique because it puts less stress on the zoonotes and it is a quick procedure. This is how you can chop the nucleus and make it into pieces and remove it with whatever parameters you are using for your routine Emulsification procedure. Now, cortex aspiration is very important thing. You have to remember that there is some zoonotic dehiscence area, and you should avoid the radial stripping of the cortex. You should do it in a tangential way. Push your aspirating cannula beneath the capsular rhexis margin, and don't pull the cortex radially. You should sweep it beneath the capsular axis margin in a tangential manner, bring the cortex in the central area, and then aspirate the cortex. This is the way for to aspirate the cortex once you have removed the nucleus. Now, if the subluxation is more than 4 o'clock hour, you need to fix the bag with the modified capsular tension ring. For that, you have to create a Hoffman pocket here and between the Hoffman pocket or scleral tunnel. The site should be a little bit away from 3 to 9 o'clock position because the long posterior ciliary artery enters at this area, and supporting the bag with the help of iris hooks or capsular hooks, and then aspirating the cortex with the help of IA probe or with the help of Simcoe's cannula, and railroading the capsular tension ring or modified capsular ring inside the bag by hooking with the help of 9-0 or 10-0 proline. 9-0 proline is preferred over 10-0 proline, and fix the ring into the sclera. This is how you can fix the ring and then place the intraocular lens inside the bag. So take home message from this lecture is choose ECR or CTR capsular tension ring depending upon the clock hours of subluxation. Incision should be away from the zonular area. Use high molecular weight viscoelastic to plug the dehiscenced area. Guide the center capsular tension ring in the back properly. Do not delay too much while implanting the intercapsular ring, and prefer CHOP technique and irrigation aspiration of the cortex by tangential technique instead of aspirating the cortex in a radial manner. So thank you so much for your patience listening. That's all from my side.
Thank you, Rajesh, for excellent elaboration of the all the point of subluxation management of the subluxated cataract and key points too. As it is a vast subject, we have to highlight something more, and especially rings. For that, I invite Dr. Mahipal Sajdev to speak especially the role of rings, hooks, and segments in the management of subluxated cataract. Dr. Mahipal.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rajiv Chaudhary. It's always a pleasure being among friends and colleagues for this particular course, which is very successfully conducted by you over the last several years. I'll be talking about the role of rings, hooks, and segments, and my task is slightly easier with the previous speaker, Dr. Joshi, having given the basis for when you need to put and what segments, etc., you need to put. The basic aim, as I would say, is to preserve the capsular bag, and this minimizes vitreous loss and allows the placement of a PCIOL, reduces the risk of retinal detachment and glaucoma, and the lens remains in position. Now, the first and the foremost important thing is that you need to have a good pre-operative assessment and also assessment in the supine position, ultrasound biomicroscopy to gauge the extent of zonular loss is also something very, very important. So this is, you can see in the picture, clinically obvious subluxation. Phacodonosis, space irregularity in the space behind the iris and the lens, and lens edge can be seen. You have to ask the patient to look into extreme gaze. Plus, you should take the history, specifically a history of trauma. Now, when you're looking at these type of cases, there could be trauma as one of the leading causes. You could have Marfan's, homocystinuria, etc., which are the other causes, which are because of issues which could be metabolic or developmental, pseudo-exfoliation syndrome, long-standing glaucoma, uveitis, high myopia. These are the important causes why you have subluxation in patients. Now, as was said by my earlier speaker, the extent of subluxation, the etiology of subluxation is something which is very important. Supposing you have a traumatic subluxation, usually it does not tend to progress. While you have a case of Marfan's, under those circumstances, you are 100% sure that the subluxation is going to progress. And then when you are managing the case, you have to look at the grade or grade of the cataract. So this has already been spoken about, subluxation. The extent is the next thing. So why it was there, the extent, CTR less than 3 clock hours, or the IOL haptics can take care. When it's 3 to 6 hours, you need a CTR and a ring fixation, or a glue could be the other one. when it is more than CTR, the ring has to be fixed to the sclera or you go on to the glued IOL. And if it is more than 180 or 200, you need to go in. I have written glued IOL, but you can go in for a Yamane technique or any other technique that is to have the lens fixated onto the sclera. Now, what is very, very important in all those cases is that when you are having the challenges faced is the creation of an intact capsule or excess. That is very crucial. Excess lens mobility and tilt and displacement makes the capsule or excess difficult. And any discontinuity of the capsular ring is a contraindication to the placement of a capsular tension ring because the rip which is there in the anterior capsule is going to extend and cause a problem. So there is again the problem of continuous vitreous hydration that happens during phaco emulsification in the eyes, and the hydration results from communication between the anterior and posterior chambers through this zonular deficiency, and this causes a positive vitreous pressure and shallowing of anterior chamber. So how can we make this easy? So let's just first talk about the two things that we are wanting to look at. One is the capsulotomy and the second is the upthrust of the vitreous that you have in these particular cases. Let me show you a patient who had irregular AC. Patient had an attack of angle closure glaucoma that you can see there is sphincteric atrophy, mid-dilated pupil, pupil is rigid, that is there. And you can see in this particular case, there is a peripheral iridotomy that has been done. And this is the sphincteric atrophy, which you can see is there in this particular case. You can see that there is an irregularity in the chamber depth, and you can see that this is a phacodonosis, which you can see very clearly. So you can see this phacodonosis. So this is a tough case for anybody to kind of take care of to be able to do a phaco emulsification. So with the immobility, of the capsule, doing a capsular excess becomes a problem. In this particular case, there is a Malugin ring that has been implanted. You can see that the iris is bowed down here. So this is where you are going to have a problem in this subluxated. So you can see that this is a femto procedure that is being done. And as we go ahead with the femto procedure, after the OCT that is done, you can see the capsulotomy and the nucleotomy. This is the capsulotomy that has been completed. This is the fractionation into various segments happening. So the important thing is that you will get a great capsulotomy in this particular case. And a femto is, I would say, a treatment of choice where the subluxation can be managed with a femto laser. So this is something which I wanted to show you, the power of femto in these particular cases. Now, once the procedure has been done, you can see here, this is the Malugin ring, which is there. You had a good capsulotomy. The hydrodissection needs to be gentle, and you do not need to rotate the nucleus very forcefully because there'll be a problem in these particular. So you can see that there is a stickiness because the hydrodissection has not been done to the extent that we wanted. And the pre-chopping has been done. Now, what happens is that it's better to use capsular hooks here. But since we did not have capsular hooks, this is an iris hook that is being used. We are putting it, and this will help hold the capsule in position. So you can see that this is now holding the capsule, and this is a pre-chopped nucleus. And the amount of manipulation that you will do to remove the nucleus is going to be much less. So pre-chopped nucleus after a good capsulotomy, taking a capsular hook, and you can see that we are able to remove the nucleus pretty well. Let's go a little forward. You can again see that there is a problem here. This is the huge dehiscence, which is in this particular case. So ideal is that we should keep it compressed with the viscoelastic. Again, we have put viscoelastic, and there is a second hook that we are putting to stabilize the capsular back. So friends, I have shown you here the iris Malugin ring that has been put, a capsulotomy that has been done, a nucleotomy that was done with the femto laser, and then we are using capsular hook, iris hooks in this particular case to support the capsule. And you can see here that we are able to, with this support, take out the entire entire epinucleus. Then the nucleus is being taken out, and you can see that we have been able to maintain the capsular bag. Now comes the time to have a stabilization of the capsular bag for even the post-operative period. So this is an endocapsular ring that has been put, And once the endocapsular ring has been poked in the bag, implantation of the lens can happen. And now the hooks and the Mulligan ring would be taken out. And we will end up, and this is a way to take out the hook from the other side. And this is the ring that is being taken out. So this is what I am saying, to look at whether there is any vitreous, just doing a cleanup of the vitreous tag that had come from the site. So the femto-assisted cataract surgery is not dependent on zonular countertraction for capsular excess. It is done in a closed chamber and allows lens fragmentation. Now, this is another case where we have a subluxation of a cataract in a doctor who came to me from Patna, 44 years post-traumatic. And what I will again show the power of femto in this particular case, and I will show you how we decompress the vitreous in these cases. So here you can see that this is a blob of vitreous. You can see this entire vitreous coming. There is the iris falling back. And now we are going ahead doing the capsulotomy. We are centering it to the place where we want to center it, so that even once we have the entire thing moving with the ring coming in, things will be fine. So this is the femto procedure, the LRI that has been done. And now what we have done in this particular case is that we have gone for the pars plana, used the trocar cannula, and we will remove the vitreous that is coming in front. So this is a decompression of the vitreous that we are doing beforehand. So you can see we have used tricot and it is a huge subluxation which is there. And this is where, even despite the vitreous coming in, the femto procedure has given you the power to get a good capsular excess, which is very, very important to do these cases. Now, vitreous decompression has been done and we have put in an endocapsular ring. So it is a pure endocapsular ring that we are putting here because it was a traumatic subluxation. We don't expect it to increase. And this is the nucleus being taken away. You can see that the nucleus goes off. We are removing the epinucleus by manual IEA, putting viscoelastic, not allowing the capsular bag to come forward, and then a three-piece lens that has been put in this particular case. So you can see that this is the way you have to do a vitreous decompression in these particular cases, and go ahead and use a posterior approach to remove the vitreous. This is the final removal of the vitreous, which we will now take out from the anterior approach and close this particular case. So this is the post-op. So vitreous decompression, whenever you are having subluxations, is something which is very, very important for you to do. Now, this is again in another case where there is a subluxation. You can see here we are not doing a femto. Look at the mobility. Can you see this capsule getting stretched? Can you see this? This will not happen in a femto, but then you can use either two forceps, micro forceps, or you can use one and have a good capsular excess that is required. Now, in this particular case, hydro has been done, but again, you use hooks. So these are the hooks, again, capsular hooks. We often just go ahead and use the iris hooks, as I've said, but capsular hook can place the whole thing, and then an endocapsular ring will be placed. This is a softish cataract. So there is no real problem in going ahead. So these supplement each other, the hooks and the endocapsular ring actually supplement each other, and you are able to get good outcome. Now, let us just see what our colleague, Dr. Suvain has done. And this is 10 times thinner than any other ring. This is the BX, and you can see how very flexible, and it goes through a very small incision. So you don't really need to enlarge the incision. And this is the Bhattacharjee ring that is there. You have these holders in place, and you can put these holders in place, and you can go ahead and you can do a femto procedure in these particular cases. Here you can see a femto procedure is being done, and at the end of the surgery you can remove this. The other thing that is there is that if there is aniridia, there is loss of iris tissue, whether it is cataract, pseudophagia, phakia, there is photophobia, glare, sensitivity, contrast loss, etc. You can use aniridic lens. You can use these segments, small segments, or you can use these windshield wiper type of segments. So there you have to put two, you put one and you put the second, and you can close it. These come in various sizes where you can have this extending right up to the center, leaving behind 3 millimeters or leaving behind 5 millimeters. It is your choice. This is a segment that is being implanted. You can see this is the segment that has been implanted. And you can see this is our case where we have put two of these aniridic segments, the whole ring, and they look like a wiper effect where one and the other go and match, and you get a good outcome. You have to be careful that the pigment stays and it does not leach and does not cause any inflammatory reaction. These are iris prosthetic systems which are not available in India, but they also give good results. This is the first...
Last.
So this is the scleral fixation of the aniridic lens, where you can see this is an eyelet, and you can go ahead and put these aniridic lens into the eye, but you need a large incision of at least 10 millimeters for the lens to be put home. So finally, the take-home message is that whenever you are doing a phaco, there has to be low fluid settings to prevent surge of fluid into vitreous cavity. Tamponade the area of zonular defect with dispersive OVD. Femto-assisted capsulotomy would reduce the risk of further complications, and the procedure of vitreous decompensation that I have shown, it allows safe phacoemulsification. Thank you very much for your kind listening, because these difficult situations often yield the most gratifying and the best results if you have these small little toys with you, as I would call, which could take care of this.
Thank you. Thank you, Maipal, for summarizing and comprehensive all the ring segment in a small talk. Definitely, it was a wide variety and wide talk. But now I invite Dr. Harbhans to speak on the repositioning, because our topic is on subluxation of cataract and intraocular lens. So I... Harbhans.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Rajiv. Wonderful program. So this is the, I'll be talking about the IUL positioning. And these days we are putting a lot of toric IULs, and we get toric surprises quite often. So whenever you get a toric surprise, we need to find out whether it can be corrected by the realignment or it cannot be corrected by realignment. What we need is, what is the post-operative total refractive error? Now, what is the post-operative astigmatism? Forget about the pre-operative. And what is the total power which can be corrected by the IUL? That means whatever is the astigmatism, whatever can be corrected, if we reduce that, the difference between the two is uncorrectable. That means if the corneal astigmatism is 2 diopter, and correction by the IUL is 1 diopter, 1 diopter cannot be corrected. So which cannot be corrected, if we reduce from the total refractive error, we'll find out what is the refractive error which can be corrected by the realignment. So first we need to find out. And the things which cannot be corrected by the toric alignment, we need to have the other options like laser correction, piggyback, and IUL exchange. Then with the residual astigmatism, like we know that the 30 degree rotation causes 0 astigmatism correction. So the with the residual astigmatism, we can calculate how much is the misalignment. So the residual correctable astigmatism is say 1 diopter, and total correctable was also 1 diopter. That means misalignment is of 30 degree. But if the total correctable was 6 diopter and residual is 1 diopter, that means 1/6 into 30, just 5 degree of misalignment. So if you see over here, if there's a 1 diopter of residual correctable astigmatism and the IUL power at the corneal plane is 1, then the misalignment is 30 degree. If it is the corneal plane correctable power is 2, it is 15 degree. At 6, it is 5 degree. So we actually do not correct the refractive error, but we correct the misalignment. So realignment is done when there is a significant misalignment and it can correct significant residual astigmatism. So we are trying to correct the misalignment, not the residual refractive. That is important to understand. So now I'll give you one example that this is a patient, 67 years old male, who had, this was the his readings, lens star 1.39 at 92 degree, pentacam at 3 millimeter was 1.5 at 93. We operated and put on a multifocal toric IUL, 16 diopter, 1.5 diopter at the IUL plane, which will correct 1 diopter at the corneal plane. So the post-operatively uncorrected distance visual acuity was 680. Best corrected visual acuity was 66. And this patient needed plus 1 diopter of spherical with 1.5 diopter slender at 30 degree. So now we calculated, as I was talking to, what is the residual refractive error. Now, the lens star readings were 1.56 at 94. and pentagram total corneal power, taking anterior and posterior combined, at 3 millimeter was 1.6 at 95, at 4 millimeter 1.1 at 81.4 degree. So we need to understand that what reading to be taken is entirely different. You can see between 3 millimeter to 4 millimeter, there is a 15 degree of gap. And even the power 1.6 to 1.1. That was the reason we chose 1.5, which will correct one diopter. So we plan to reorient this lens at 90 degree. So when we correct this, I do not have to go to any astigmatismspecs.com. You do not have to know any preoperative data. You just find out what IUL is, what is the refractive error, and what is the keratometric value. And you can realignment the lens as it is a freshly operated. So this is the now patient. So this is the toric multifocal IUL. So we have put on a reference mark, which is slightly on the temporal. When we place for the toric IUL any mark, we are not putting at 6 o'clock. You need to understand, you can never be exact at 6 o'clock. It is a reference mark which gives you the guideline where the 6 o'clock is. So after putting the mark, I found out that this my mark was slightly onto the temporal side, and 6 o'clock will be onto the nasal side of this mark. So this is very, very essential. Then I give the indentation with the chopper, which can stay for longer. Of course, this is a short case. This is not required to have such a strong marks and indentation. But still, whenever you put on a 3 marks, mostly the peripheral mark is far more accurate than the central mark, because that is being placed closer to the ring. So after this has been placed, we open the previously made side port incision. It opens up very gently without any problem. And normally I make single side port incision. So I make another side port incision for this, because we do not want to open the main incision. There is no need to open the main incision because we don't have to remove anything. So we go underneath the capsular excess margin and inject some amount of sodium hyaluronate over there. And this bag, because it's just 2 week old surgery, you can see the sodium hyaluronate goes between the two bags very easily. And then you go from the other side and do the same thing, put on a little bit of viscoelastic. I prefer hyaluronic acid for one reason, not for removal rotation of the lens, but it can be completely removed, from the bag very easily afterwards, so that the capsular bag does not remain lubricated. If you put on a methyl cellulose at the capsular bag, it will remain lubricated and you won't be able to remove it completely, and the lens may rotate again. So we now very easily this lens, I have separating the anterior capsule with the posterior capsule, and this lens is the optic haptic junction is not so strong, so the capsular separation is very much needed, and gently keep on rotating this lens. And in this case, the excess is a little larger than usual, you can see. I have got a tendency to make little larger excess in my routine cases also. So I prefer the excess around 5 to 5.5. But in a toric IUL, probably 4.5 to 5 may be a better choice for a better coverage of the optics. So once this lens is dialed into the position, and now you can see that this lower part has come to the position, but upper part is still far up because of the not so much of a strength on its knee. So now we'll bring that back. And once this is done, we remove the viscoelastic completely. And you can see that once the viscoelastic is removed, lens is positioned. And now the residual refractive error was 0.25 diopter. Pre-alignment was also spherical equivalence 0.25 diopter. And patient has 6-6 vision. Now this the realignment will not work if there is a large spherical equivalent, non-correctable astigmatism, irregular astigmatism, donor dilusis, PCT, fibrosis of the capsule. And nowadays, to prevent the decentration in any case of genoglopathy, it is safer to put on a CTR ring. Like in this case, you can see there is a large pseudo-exfoliation. In the future, there are chances of this lens might get subluxated or get decentered. So why not to prevent it before it? And so after removing the cataract, though there is not so much of a subluxation, but because of the general weakness, I will guide this CTR inside. So I've started using CTR more. It takes 30 seconds to 1 minute to put on a CTR, and cost of the CTR is less than 500 rupees. So anywhere, whenever you've got a doubt, it's better to put on a CTR ring. As already taught by Dr. Rajesh Joshi, I always use the bi-manual technique. keep on pushing the shaft of it. And this is another case where there is a very little, you can see there is a fold onto this side where I'm going to remove the cortex. And this is because of some of the genules are broken, whether intraoperative or preoperatively, I don't know. And when I'm pulling it, you can see the edge of the back. So I mean, in such cases, I'll prefer to put on a CTR, though it is very small, because you may never know whether it was a traumatic or whether it is a progressive. And the life expectancy of these patients is now actually very large. So we put on a CTR to ensure that the lens is well centered. Particularly if you are going to use the multifocal lens, then it's very, very critical and crucial. The centration is very important. Now, this is the another case where you will see that when after putting the lens, what you can see is the rectus margin flutter. It's the shaking the rectus margin when I'm removing the viscoelastic. So that's not a very good, that means the bag is not so stable and you can see the fluttering of the rectus margin. Even in such cases, I'll prefer to put on a CTR, and though lens has been placed, you can put on a CTR on top of the lens. And so it's best to avoid the misalignment so that there is no decentration. And even the aspheric IULs, which we use now 90% of the time, they also, if they are decentered by more than 0.5 millimeter, it may compromise on the quality of the vision. So we put on a CTR ring over there, and this goes in very comfortably without any problem, in spite of the lens being inside. So place it over there. And thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Thank you all.
Thank you, Arbans. Nice presentation and completion on the time. So our time is short. Now I invite Dr. Ashok Shroff to speak on the IOL exchange in cases of the subluxated IOL. Dr. Shroff, please. Dr. Shroff.
Yeah, hold on. Can you see the screen?
Yeah. Sir, visible, sir. Yes.
Okay, fine. Thank you. First of all, thank you, Rajiv, for inviting me to participate in his wonderful course. And before Hubble's leave, let us congratulate him for being a president, the vice president for the society.
Yes.
Now, this IOL exchange is required when your IOL, when you already placed it, or you are about to place it and there is some problem. Either the IOL, when you insert it, the haptic breaks, or when the IOL is subluxated or dislocated, and you want to put the same IOL, but I mean, repose is the same IOL, either in sulcus or fixed to the sclera. But it is not possible when you have a capsular support is not inadequate, or IOL is no haptics, like Zeiss IOLs or triangular haptics, or IOL or haptic breaks when you want to repose it, the IOL. So let us see the very haptic breaks during the insertion. The IOL needs to be explanted, and you put a new IOL.
So microwave mein garam kar dega.
You can see here the IOL has been already put in, and I have noticed that here I wanted to repose it in the bag, but there I noticed that the haptic has already broken on this side. And now this lens needs to be explanted. Now, what we do normally, we extend the incision and explant it, but what I do to the same size incision, I hold the haptic. Take it out first and then cut the lens, not in completely half, but then lens, try to cut it. Now try to pull it out. Here, what I made a mistake, that I was trying to put it out because the hulls are not properly made. And you will see that even this haptic is about to break. You can see that it is also broken now. So there is a lens without haptics. And you can see the cut was very small. So I'm holding it the intravitreal forceps here. And then I'm going to the scissor. I mean, they put it into the scissor and making a real big cut into the lens. Now these lens, once I hold it with the forceps from the main wound, see, you can see that for the same size, you can gradually explant like this, rotate it a little bit, and then just take it the second portion out. So the lens is explanted the same size of the wound. The wound was not needed to be enlarged. This is removed and you can put the new IOL. Now, there is a lens which has been dislocated. The haptics are not proper. If you want to put it into the real good available support, but still you cannot. So this lens is stably taken out, explanted, and the only solution is you must put on the new IOL, which has to be fixed to the sclera. Now, there are different various methods, and of late, very, very good methods have come up, like glued IOL or the Yomini technique, and a lot of modifications. But what we do here, see, we have to, I have taken this lens out into the anterior chamber. It is a triangular haptic. It has been brought out because the capsular bag was also dislocated. You can see that there is a triangular haptic. Now, it is difficult to fix the same lens to the sclera. So you have to take it out. Now, this is my favorite technique of suturing the lens to the sclera, which I have been practicing more than 25 years now. And the two sutures, the partial sclerotomy wound is fashioned here on either side, exactly equidistant from the limbus. And then both the sutures at a little distance, they are brought out. So this is the only part, this is intraocular. And once it is, the sutures are taken out, they are cut properly, and then they are fashioned to the eyelet. This is usually I used to use two eyelets on the haptics, but now they are not available. So I'm using one eyelet on either haptics. The suture is fashioned, it is tied so the it doesn't flee, and then it is tied to the another portion of the suture, because there are two sutures we have fashioned. So then this part is introduced into the chamber, and then the haptic, the trailing haptic is still kept out, and the suture is fashioned through the eyelet. It is fixed, and again it is tied with the other suture, guiding suture, and then the suture, you can see that the lens has gone inside. You can pull the sutures simultaneously together, and you can center the lens. And once it is centered, see, this is, you have to tie, and the node goes into the depth of the sclera. You can see that. So this is how we do it. And then suppose the same lens or similar lens, we want to put it the same way, but then what happens? Because it breaks during the manipulation, and it is so frustrating. You can see that I usually, in these cases, when I want to repose it the same lens, I usually use triangular flap, go through, put a, you can see that here, the sclerotomy incision, and then through, do the vitrectomy, clear everything so that the vitreous doesn't remain in the anterior chamber. The one haptic is brought out, it is fashioned, but there are no eyelets. So, but still you can hold, tight, and then the sutures are gone through the scleral lips similarly. But then at the end, I realized that the lens was so decentered, and during maneuveration, I did the vitrectomy, and then I just wanted to fashion it and centralize it. But then of late, doing all this maneuveration, I realized that the lens has, the haptic has broken here. You can see that. So the only way left is to explant the lens, and then we have to put the another lens. Same way, the method what I've shown you in the previous video clipping, the two sutures are passed through the sclera, and then they are fashioned in the eyelet, and then the lens is introduced and put it into the behind the iris, and then the sutures are fashioned, the IOL is centered, and they are tight. You will see here that it's a different suture here. See, you can see that. You can see that here. This was our earlier, but then this was a different, we have gone through the different site. So this is how the IOL, dropped IOL has been sutured. There are other methods which you can fix it to the sclera, which has been very popular nowadays, like glued IOL or the Yomini technique. This is the video clipping I borrowed from my colleague, and he has done a modified Yamini technique. You can see that about 1.5 millimeter from the limbus, the tunnel is fashioned on either side of the sclera. You can see here. Similarly, on this side, the lens is now brought over here. The one haptic is glued here. I mean, they put inside, and then little vitrectomy is done. This here also. Then it is entered. You can see that it is brought out here and going to, it is being put here into the tunnel. You can see here. And similarly, this haptic is also fashioned here. It put into the tunnel here and it is closed. So this is how we do different techniques to fix the IUL or expand the IUL and put a new one. Thank you, Raju.
Thank you, Dr. Shroff, for excellent presentation and dislocated IOL and management. So now I am going to speak on the retrofixation of the IOL. Screen share. Pehle screen lena hai. So my topic on the retrofixation of iris cloud, it is one of the important lens and easy to manipulate, especially in the when there is no capsular support or other option is not available. It is one of the easiest procedure which can be used in subluxated cataract and IOL once you remove the IOL, apart from grooved IOL and scleral fixated IOL. So it is the advancement in technique and IOLs, good visual outcome is achieved in subluxated cataract and IOL. There are the multiple causes of the subluxation and dislocated IOLs, congenital, traumatic, metabolic, consecutive. So decision regarding the surgical intervention as per the genular desensitization. So there is a nomogram which you can do, whether it is 3 o'clock, 5 o'clock, 5 to 7 or more than, and according to you can plan CTR and everything. So my topic is only the iris cloud. So I am going to cover only on that retrofixation of iris cloud. It is one of the good lens designed by John Wurst and then modified by Dr. Daljit Singh, which I am using since last 30 years. And it is one of the good option in extreme subluxation and compromised PC. Why iris cloud? Easy to implant once you learn, less chances of secondary glaucoma, rate of dislocation is less, less endothelium, less loss. There are the multiple study on this. Endothelial cell loss was comparable to scleral fixated IOL and better than interchamber IOL. And it is a good option in eye with inadequate posterior capsular support. What are the contraindications? Recurrent iritis because it is clogged to the iris. Rubella cataract, severe iris atrophy, when there is no iris support. Still, we can use if there is some part of the iris available. Uncontrolled chronic glaucoma, corneal dystrophy or degeneration. How you see that inclavation? Haptic attached to the mid-periphery, which is probably immobile iris. Normal vasculature and nerve supply will not interfere. Allow pupil unrestricted dilatation and constriction. It will be slightly elliptical. And there is a study with the fluorescein angiography that show there is a no leakage of the iris vessel at the site of inclavation. It is how you see the inclavation in the when it is probed antechamber, and it is a dent when it is a posterior placement, retrofixation. So we, it is an animation how to you can, it is simple. It's a two side port incision, 180 degree apart, main incision. It will be the 4.5 to 5 mm length. Inject viscoelastic or tricot and do the good anterior vitrectomy. then put the pilocarpi so to the constrict the pupil, then inject viscoelastic in the anterior chamber. Then this is the claw lens. You can see there is a two claw 180 degree apart. Put directly from 90 degree and then rotate it horizontally with the two hooks. Once you place it the proper direction with the lens holding progression on that side of the claw, the important step is you have to hold firmly at this point here so that that enclavation is done completely. Again, re-inject the viscoelastic. There might be some leakage of the visco. Hold at the other side and firmly hold the lens so that it doesn't tilt. And you can see that how simple it is. So we move to the formula calculated. The best is the SRKT or Barrett's. And anti-chamber, if you do, it is 115. And if it is on the posterior placement, because it is far away from the cornea, 116.5. So how you can implant different situation? It is a severe subluxated cataract. There is no option. Either you have scleral fixator glue. Once you have completed the, I'm just fast forwarding, completed the lensectomy, put the pilocarpi. The pupil is round, side port. The lens is placed horizontally and holding firm from that side of the lens, that inclination is there. You can see that how simple the process is. It will hardly take fraction of second to enclave that lens in place. And it is, you can do the iridectomy as you wish, and that lens is in the place. Another, it is a case of dislocated nucleus doing surgery when removed. I will skip that once because it is a complicated situation. Again, doing scleral fixated or glue out, right. It is more traumatic. You can see that in cases of dislocated, once you manage with the phacofragmentation, how simple it is to put that intraocular lens in the place. The 4.5, so it is slightly need a pressure to go in, and that inclavation is quite. Only thing you have to keep other haptic, other part of the haptic anterior to iris before inclavation, because it may slip into the posterior chamber. That's simple. There is a case of subluxated IOL implanted because of the genular dystrophy. The whole intraocular lens and bag was dislocated. So there is no option. Either you have to use iris glass, glued IOL, remove this in toto, do the good anterior vitrectomy as I mentioned in the animation. And once you're done, put the pilocarpine, viscoelastic. So your complicated process is made quite simple by putting the iris claw lenses. It's a hook. You can use a small thin lens hook also, lens holding faucet. The only important point that you have to hold this lens firmly while inclavation. Many times it is feared that this may lens dislocate because of the iristropy. It is very rare, but advantage of that, whenever it dislocate, it is always, there is a one side it inclavate and you can easily re-inclavate. This is a dislocated from that left side. We have simply broad back lens into the upper part anterior chamber and again re-inclavate it in the slim. Same place. So inclavation is done. washing is simple, remove the viscoelastic. So in short, iris claw implantation is easy to implant, lesser complication rate, and it gives the good visual retina. And especially in severe jaundular dialysis. Stay safe and healthy. Thank you. Thank you very much. Now I invite Dr. Nishlana to speak on scleral fixated and glue diode.
Good morning, everyone, and especially the thanks to Dr. Chaudhary sir and AIO Scientific Committee for allowing me to put into this instruction course and to allow me to share a few of the thoughts of the glued IOL, which I did in the beginning. I have purposely taken this glued IOL and try to show that what practical difficulty I had in the beginning so that a learner can have a more chance to learn from these mistakes and he can, I mean, say disallow or not to repeat those mistakes particularly. So if you go to the history, Maggie and Maggie in 1997, they started the scleral fixated IOL. Dr. Graber Sharif from the Germany, he started putting into a scleral tunnel. And finally, Dr. Amar Agarwal from India, he started making the flaps and started using the glue. And that is how everything has changed the scenario of a glued IOL, particularly as far as its advantages are concerned. So coming to our indications of primary or the secondary glued IOL, idea is just to correct the aphakia in absence of any capsular support. This is very essential. Whenever there is a deficit of capsular support, either you got into a trouble of PCR or the complicated situation of subluxated lenses, which have been shown previously by the speakers. So this is the ideal way of doing it. You can do it a primary, secondary, or as an IOL exchange, particularly. The other way, methods of doing these IOLs already have been shown, like the iris fixated IOL. The another, which again is a popular in so many of surgeon, is the angle supported anterior chamber IOL, and a sulcal placed IOL. That again is one of the modality to deal with all these situations. Anterior chamber IOL or the angle fixated IOL are to be avoided, particularly in situation like angle abnormalities, glaucoma, or the corneal endothelial damage. It all depends upon the choice of a surgeon, particularly what variety of the IOL he is going to use. It could be a anterior chamber IOL or the posterior chamber IOL or the glued fixated, scleral fixated IOL. The advantages of these glued IOL is well-centered, good stability, no pseudophakodonosis, and it is good for these locations because the stability is very high. It's not going to touch the anterior chamber anyhow. The pre-operative evaluation that we need to see that the cornea is a clear, endothelial cell count has to be a good one. If at all there's a vitreous in the anterior chamber, that has to be dealt during the surgery and to evaluate it further, how the condition of iris, the important has to be one, which is to be seen as a posterior segment evaluation, peripheral retina, macula and optic nerve, because you need to give a good result to the patient. IOL power calculation practically remains the same what we calculate for the posterior chamber IOL, but keeping a little myope patient, a half adapter is ideal, and it's a good situation to do it. Now coming to the video of this glued IOL, it is always advisable to mark the 180 degree the line where you want to implant the glued IOL. This can be done with simple markers. Once that part is done, you can definitely go ahead with the conjunctival dissection, do a proper cautery, and then you need to make the scleral pockets. The idea is this, the scleral pockets has to be of 2.5 or 3 millimeter width. It should not, the width should not be more than 2.5 or 3 millimeter. Otherwise, you need to find a difficulty in tucking the haptic of the IOL, because broader is the haptic, less length will be available for the haptic to tuck in. You can make a side entry, and after, thereafter you can go with the AC maintainer to maintain the anterior chamber the pressure always, which is required, not to go for any kind of hypotony while you are doing the surgery after the this AC maintainer. You can go 1.5 millimeter away from limbus into the vitreous to make a scleral entry, and then making a tunnel in line with this scleral entry, which is 1.5 millimeter. This tunnel is going to catch the haptic or keep the haptic in place. So this is very important, and marking it with a gentian violet is always a good idea. Put a little bit of orocort or canacort so that whatever vitreous is lying in the pupillary area has to be taken care of. It has to be practically vitreous free. You can use three-piece IOL, which is the ideal one for this situation. Keep this IOL haptic a little exposed while you are injecting into the anterior chamber. Sorry, there's a little problem. So this was to catch hold. I caught this one with the 23 gauze forceps, but the mistake which probably I did in the initial part was let this tip of the haptic and the forceps must remain in the pupillary area. I dragged it a little bit and I thought I missed it. So that was the one mistake that we should not commit. Now I tried to catch it from a tip of the haptic, and I was trying to focus it, but probably it could not part from the proper place, and it got snapped into the the scleral tunnel of externalization. And here you can see the IOL has been deformed or twisted up. So these are the few of the initial points one must learn while doing these cases and try to avoid the mistake. So now this IOL, which was damaged, can't be implanted. I took out that IOL and with enlargement of incision, and the same IOL with enlarged incision was implanted. Now this time I was very cautious that I am not going to lose the tip, and that has been exercised properly. You definitely have to a good support of the assistant, how he is dealing with you, how he is coordinating with you. That is again more important. So these are the few of the mistakes. Later on, when we realize, we tried to come out with a solution of it so that So after the excisation of these two, you can see the IOL is very stable. The one of the haptic has already been inserted into the tunnel. The second tunnel, probably because of scleral pressure and inadvertent use of pressure there with the haptic of the IOL, that probably got disfigured. So we might find difficulty in the beginning, and I had to make a second tunnel in the same place. And you can see a little bit of the tip of the haptic already has been bent up. That you need to take care, make it straight, and then go back again to a proper tunnel, which you refreshened it. So these are the few of the things that probably you need to check in when you're doing it for the first time. AC maintainer has taken away, air has been put into it so as to avoid the hypotony. That is again very important issue. The glue which is taken into two syringes, apply below the flap one after another, spread it nicely, and then definitely glue can be applied to the conjunctival area as well. Put little bit of intracameral antibiotic, and finally the subconjunctival injection that you prepare. Thank you. Thanks for patiently.
Thank you, Vijay. Thank you. Excellent presentation on your finishing. So now we come to the panel discussion. Any question? Probably there is no question visible on the...
No, but we can talk now. I mean, the question for Dr. Joshi. Is he there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, he's there.
See, when I was watching your video, in one of the video, you wanted to, you discuss about how to aspirate the cortex. At that time, the pupil had become very small. So you already implanted the CTR ring. So in that case, do you think you would advocate, suppose it is difficult, means you would like to advocate the use of either the ID soup or the CapsuCare to enlarge the pupil so that you still, don't damage the zonules further?
That's a good idea. The patient which I was operating was a diabetic and his pupil was rigid. And it failed to dilate with adrenaline also, but it's a good idea.
Yeah.
To put any type of iris expanders, like maybe BHEX pupil expander or iris hooks, because the visibility is very important while performing any procedure, and blindly going into the area may damage the further weakened zones. So it's a good idea to implant, to put iris hooks in that area.
Thank you.
So panel discussion is important to enhance the knowledge and keep going to learn something new. Especially this question start with Rajesh. Which phaco technique is preferred in subluxated cataract?
Yes, sir. As far as
you have already elaborated in, but in short, you can summarize in the.
Yeah, I prefer to have a CHOP technique for nucleus management in my most of the procedure, because it produces less, it gives less zonular stress on the zonules.
Okay.
So mostly I prefer CHOP technique.
What will you do? You have seen this question is to Dr. Shroff. Preferred CTR or not? You are seeing that photo of the subluxation, and which CTR, whether the suture or without suture? Dr. Shroff?
Yes. See, if the subluxation is very small, less than a...
Oh, no, that visible, that photo you are seeing.
Here?
Is visible? That photo is clear? I can show you the...
Oh, the whole. Yeah. In that case, my technique is very simple, because I'm very happy with the scleral fixated IOL. I will remove the cataract and put a scleral fixated IOL.
Cannot be an option to suture that ring segment or any CTR to be sutured.
I'm very comfortable with scleral fixated IOL, sir.
Urbans, what you will prefer?
No, I think, are you going to remove the bag, or with the bag you will leave it there and then...
It is your choice what you are going to remove.
No, I will be, of course, putting the CTR. I will not go for a scleral fixation, because the vitreous phase in the most of the part is intact. Why to disturb it?
This is your condition of that...
This is CTR fixation. There is no doubt about it. So this is... I usually prefer to fix with the CTR. And if there is a one side CTR, I feel it is not getting centered, I'll put on a double CTR, both sides hooks. Even if I put on a one CTR, then I can use the Sionis with the ring, and I break it and make it a segmental Sionis.
Vijay, what you will
do? I always put Sionis in these cases.
Putting a CONE is always initial trial, and if it stabilizes the bag and allows us to put the IUL, then it will be a great help, because you are going to maintain the bag integrity and putting the IUL and making it fix with the
Dr. Shaw, which is the preferred and safe to use in subluxated bag and why? Iris soup or capsule? Are you using that for holding the bag? Iris soup or capsular hook?
Yes, my choice is capsular hook, always. Okay. Always. Yes, because you can see here, the gap is more. So when
gap is more and they are comparatively more saved. If you have the available, probably use the capsular hook. If it is not available, then the second option is the iris hook.
Basic advantage is that the capsular hook press onto the equator while the iris hook lift onto the rectus margin. So that is the advantage, because the capsular hook being longer, the pressure is on the equator of the capsule. The pressure on the rectus margin is not there. So that is the biggest advantage of the capsular hook.
I think it is individual choice.
So, the next question is the role of alpha-GAN eye drops in dislocated IOL or subluxated, not exactly dislocated, subluxated, when patient having dysphotopsia.
No idea. No
it is mentioned that, Harbans, you have any idea?
No idea. Or the alpha-GAN eye drops.
Probably it is said that alpha-GAN gives some sort of meiosis and that will prevent that aberration. Rakesh, you are here. You can allow.
I don't have any ideas.
When would you like to keep the cases of decentered IOLs under observation and when to do surgical? There is a slight decentration. What are the guidelines to when to intervene and when not to intervene? Because just slight decentration and patient is not having any problem. Vijay, any guidelines you want to give something that what we should look for that?
First of all, particularly in these cases, we must dilate the patient and try to see what exactly is the site of dislocation or subluxation and what is the degree of it. And how about the pseudophacodonesis? If it is a slight one, decentered little bit of it, there's no pseudophacodonesis much on it, then probably we can just keep on observing and keep calling the patient regularly for intervals. But see what happens with the due course of time, the bag contracts. And this is how the zonulinolysis increases. Once the pseudophacodonesis starts, then probably the decenters is practically of that level that it gives a problem to the patients. And then you can have a different choice of IOL, whether you can refix them or take it out and put the other variety of IOL like glued IOL, iris clip, or scleral fixation IOL.
One important point I would like to highlight over here. If any time the patient has got a say defective cylinder of say 5 diopter, now do the keratometry and see whether the cylindrical power is less on keratometry. Like I recently operated a patient who was unhappy with his vision, and the defective cylinder was in the tune of 6 diopter, while the keratometric cylinder was only 1 diopter. True. So this 5 diopter of the cylindrical error was because of the IUL, which was slightly decentered and subluxated, though it was stable for many years. So we removed and put it over there, and the patient was very thankful. The doctors, first time somebody has identified what problem I am having. So the though the lens was already, it was a four pod type of lens, but you need to find out the cylindrical difference between the refraction and keratometry also.
Probably here the iTrace will help. That will differentiate the corneal astigmatism and intraocular lens. I will show one of the photo on this. So now this question to all, one by just a short summary, the IOL of choice during managing decentered IOL and why. Only short 10 seconds for each speaker. Start with the Nishlani. What is your choice? What you will do? There is a decentered IOL and is gone. Now you have to choose scleral fixated glued IOL or iscla. Why?
If iris is all practically available, I'll go with the iris claw IOL, because this is a easier way and a shorter way of...
Dr. Shaw?
To reposition the IOL, same IOL to the sclera.
Yes. You mean to say you will go for scleral fixated IOL?
never fixated without taking the same IOL out of the eye.
Okay, Rajesh?
Iris closer. For the
Arvans, Arvans, we are the majority for iris claw here.
I prefer glued IOL as clear as fixated IOL. Probably I do not have so much of experience of the iris claw lenses as you people have. In fact, I wanted to know how is your experience. Because whenever there is a debate between the glued IOL and scleral fixated IOL, the glued IOL technically seems much more sound as compared to the iris fixated, because iris fixated looks easier, faster, quicker, but glued IOL gives a better stability.
No, but that iris claw is also very, very well stable. If you engrave it in the mid-ferry, I will also prefer the iris claw.
Yeah.
And once you are used to iris claw, you will not think of anything else.
Looking at your video, sir, definitely.
In your practice, how do you assess the role of femto laser in managing of subluxated cataract? Probably it is very well highlighted by the Mahipal.
Yeah.
So anybody want to share anything? Or what is four-point scleral fixated IOL designed by? It is question to Dr. Shroff, sir. Dr. Shroff?
Yes. See, there were two islets on either haptics. So there are 4-point fixation to the sclera.
Probably, this is house.
Yes, yes, it was.
You have some photograph it here. We have some time.
No, not right now. I don't know. It was.
So it is designed by you or something?
Yes, yes. I designed it with the help of Sudhir Nambiar at the care group of IOL Baroda. But then because the consumption was less, so probably it was not profitable or a. The company thought it is not good to continue. So they can make it customize on demand. And now The range of price.
What is the advantage?
Excellent. It gives very good centration and minimum cylinder. Minimum cylinder.
Okay. I'm going to share that the role of ITRES in managing the decentered IOL. You can see that on enlargement, this is the complaint of the patient, and when dilated pupil, there is the total aberration is much more, and it is indicating that aberration is from the lens is much more than cornea. This is corneal aberration, this is the lens ablation. So this is the probably the one of the reason where you interfere with the intraocular lens. So in short, thank you. Any question, anything, Harbans, you want to add? We have 5 minutes more.
I think a very well conducted session actually, and a much needed session, because we get a lot of patients for the secondary IOL implantation. It's good that this panel has emphasized the role of iris fixated IOL, which is much quicker, much faster. And while there has been more shift towards the glued IOL and more hype around the glued IOL, but probably iris fixated IOL are equally effective and may work wonders. And particularly very good, and the cost effective actually good. I will really 10,000 of the glue, and then you need to have a vitrectomy, you need to have the infusion, so much more simpler technique. And
basically, faster. It is more time scleral fixated glued oil, comparatively more time consuming and slightly more traumatic than iris claw, because you always need this at the time of some complication, which are already there is a trauma to the eye.
You are stressed at that time.
So your aim should be to less traumatize the IOL implantation. Sir, Vijay, you want to add something for this whole course? You want to add something to topic for the listener about the any point to be taken care for the subluxated cataract and IOL, which probably we might have missed?
I think practically we have covered all the points, whatever we need to observe, particularly in this subluxated or dislocated IOL. It sometimes become a personal choice of a surgeon, how he acclimatize, particularly whether he want to reposition IOL, he want to take it IOL as a exchange IOL, then put iris clip IOL or scleral fixated, sulcus fixated, or maybe a glued IOL. So the way you are basically trained and you have seen the mentor that he is doing this way of surgery, so you practically start with doing with that variety of surgery, and later on you can, shift to the other variety of secondary IOL or the exchange of IOL, depending upon the things that you learn in the due course of time. And then particularly you can decide that, yes, this could be a best way of doing IOL and giving good result to the patient. So sometimes it's practically a personal choice. I've seen many more surgeons putting angle supported anterior chamber IOL, and they are being followed regularly and doing very well. No corneal problem or corneal issues later on in the due course of time.
Rajesh?
The only thing I'd like to add one thing, whenever people put ACIUL, because we have used ACIUL earlier, so the young generation is not aware of how to put the ACIUL, so they put the convexity backwards. So the convexity should be away from the pupil. That means they are a little scared it might damage the cornea, so they put it other way around and the pupil gets captured. So convexity should be away from the pupil. That means when you put into the posterior chamber, the convexity is backward. When you put in the anterior chamber, convexity is forward. So that is very important for the people to remember when they put on anterior chamber as well.
Rajesh?
Sir, any special instruments you recommend for posterior iris claw fixation?
No, simple. If you can, simple iris hook, which is thin. So thinner iris claw. You just search this thinner iris hook, which can go with the claw, and simple lens, make any lens holding forceps. Only important thing is to hold the that lens towards the claw, not exactly at mid periphery, in the middle, it is to the periphery towards the claw which you are going to enclave. So it should reduce the pressure of the enclavation. That is the important thing. That is the only important step. Rest is very simple.
Now, most of the time, I wonder about visualization of posterior iris claw while enclavation. So that was my concern. So how do you identify that claw or catch on the iris?
Show you the dimple there, so that you have catch hold of this. And once you are hold, you just slightly move your forceps and you see that iris is moving.
Okay.
So, and it is exactly when you are putting it is behind the iris, you know that where is the claw, claw is going, and exactly opposite your incision, your needle, hook will go, or needle will go through that.
You prefer
so once you, once one or two times, you, if you try it, it is very simple.
Even sir, it can be enclaved with a 30 gauze needle.
Yeah. But that sometimes that needle have the point and it can traumatize and iris. So it you have the blunt, thin iris hook. That is the ideal instrument for this.
Shaft of that needle can be.
Initially, that inclination needle used to come with this iris claw, but nobody was much using. So that is not available nowadays.
And ideally, the concavity has to be kept anteriorly while you are implanting.
Yes.
That is an important point one must understand. Try to see that where the concavity is there. And that concavity, if it is kept anteriorly, the haptics which are for enclavation, they definitely come in close contact with the iris. Just tent it a little bit and then dip into the iris matter that enclavates the iris matter and your work is done.
Dr. Anjani, exactly what I said, convexity should be away from the pupil.
Whether
the lens is in the anterior chamber or the posterior chamber. If it is in the posterior chamber, convexity away from the pupil, anterior chamber, convexity away from the pupil, so that the pupil is mobile.
Yes, sir.
So, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Shroff, Dr. Harbans, Dr. Nishlani, Dr. Rajesh Joshi for actively participating and the Maipal. Actively participating in this course. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Raj.